And since the border is entirely porous, it's hard to distinguish, you know, one place from the other. There's no line on the map which the al-Qaeda are observing and refusing to cross. They moved from Afghanistan largely into Pakistan, and they have infiltrated often subsequently, and they can move freely across that border. And if the Taliban gains strength and takes over large swaths of Afghanistan, and they have been gaining momentum, then al-Qaeda's ability to move freely throughout Afghanistan is radically enhanced. And that is a clear and present threat to our national security.
It could also be said that al-Qaeda could take over Somalia, which has ceased to function as a regular state. It could also be said that al-Qaeda, which is deep penetration into parts of Yemen, in parts of that country that could be described as very, very challenged in terms of its governance, could have a home base and a safe haven
could,
there.
Could, but doesn't.
But and could, but doesn't in Afghanistan right
no,
now.
No, has and will. To the extent that the Taliban is able to take over increasing swaths of that territory. Because the difference is, in Yemen, in Somalia, which has no government, the Taliban is an authority that, when it was the government in Afghanistan, gave every aid, support, and comfort to al-Qaeda, and will do so to the extent that they are able going forward.
Al-Shabaab wouldn't qualify in that recounts.
You want to talk about Somalia? I'm happy to talk
please.
About Somalia.
I mean, I see a lot of parallels there. Why aren't we invading?
Well, first of all, we are involved in efforts to counter al-Qaeda wherever it exists. But al-Shabaab is not governing in Somalia. It is not even the responsible authority in substantial portions of Somalia. But yes, we have every reason to be concerned about Somalia, but it is not the hotbed and the focal point of al-Qaeda. That is in the Pakistan-Afghanistan border area. It has been for over a decade. And it is from that region in South Asia that trainers from all over the world have gone for support, for instruction, and then they have fanned out elsewhere. So to leave untended that critical region from which they have an active and operative safe haven, to examine other parts of the world would be counterproductive. We don't have that luxury.
To be able to make that sort of a definitive geographic case for why it matters to be involved here in such great numbers, at such great cost, heading into year nine, heading into year 10 in this place, we have to consider that parts of 9/11 were planned in the United States. Great parts of the United of 9/11 were planned in Germany. There doesn't have to be a safe haven in order for al-Qaeda to launch terrorist
That's
attacks against
true.
Us.
But where there is a safe haven, their ability to train, to plan, and to acquire resources and act on the basis of those resources is substantially enhanced. It is a fact that it is not essential to have a safe haven in order to conduct a terrorist attack. But where you do have a safe haven, you have the ability to project much more violence, plan and train for many more operations, and it is a far greater threat than simply an individual cell or an individual plotter.
Ambassador Susan Rice, our UN ambassador, A, you're very good at this. B, it's very good of you to give me this time, and I'm hoping you wouldn't mind sticking around for just a couple more questions. Is that okay?
Yes.
All right, good. All right, diplomatic victory. Thank
How
you.
Long we'll,
be... we'll be right back.